My God, that is who you are. By the power of your name. read this morning. This is Luke chapter 10. And it's the story of Jesus sending you and I. How many of you know that when we read about what Jesus asked his followers to do, that includes you and I? Come on, say amen. And that includes me, right? So he sent them out to do all kinds of things. You know, he says some bad things about Chorazin and Bethsaida and Capernaum. But he sends these disciples out, not just the 12, the 72 sends them out to do some stuff. And then they return. And this is in verse 17. It says, now the 72 returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. Yeah, I never saw the humor in this before this morning. But they come back and they're like, dude, you're never going to believe it. We went out. It was the most incredible thing. I mean, that's how we come to the Lord sometimes, right? We ask the Lord for something and he does it. We're like, whoa, you're never going to believe it. They're like, whoa. I'll read it to you. Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And then he said to them, well, I watched Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Behold, I have given you authority to walk on snakes and scorpions and the authority over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will injure you. Whoa. So here's the humorous part. Dude, you're never going to believe it. You're never going to believe it, Lord. Even the demons are subject to us in your name. And Jesus is like, well, duh. I saw Satan fall out of heaven like lightning. And I have given, in other words, Jesus is like, yeah. I kicked his butt out of heaven a long time ago. And that authority that I have to do that, I've given to you. So nothing's going to come. Nothing's going to harm you. Nothing's going to injure you. That's what it says. That's what it says. Nothing's going to injure you. Nothing's going to harm you. Of course. See, Jesus knew who he was. And his disciples knew who he was. And I wonder sometimes, do I know who you are? Do I really know who you are? Or do I just talk about you like some third person entity in my life? Or do I know who you are? Because see, when we discover who he is, oh, come on. Dude, you're never going to believe it. The most incredible thing happened. Well, of course it happened. I was driving in thinking about lightning because this was rolling around in my mind this morning. I saw heaven or Satan kicked out of heaven like lightning. Lightning's fast. I mean, it's not like Jesus had to walk Satan by the hand out of the courtroom. This was not a slow thing. I mean, once the deed was done, he was kicked out. It happened just like that. But then he says, but don't rejoice over this. Rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Come on, let's bring that last verse up again. And in that context, I want you to see this like we haven't seen it before. Come on. That last verse. This is when the devil thought that he had won. Souls of all who'd come to the Father were restored. come to Jesus in Luke chapter 10, they're like, oh, you're never going to believe what happened. Jesus already knows. But what is that? That's them sharing testimony with Jesus. They come back, tell Jesus what had happened in their ministry and in their life. Rooms filled today with a bunch of human beings that are trying to overcome the enemy of our souls. The book of Revelation tells us there's two ways to overcome the enemy. One is by the blood of the Lamb, and the other is by the power of the word of our testimony. The power of the word of our testimony. I want to take a moment. We don't have a lot of time, but I want to take a moment this morning. Last Sunday, at the end of service, we had a time of prayer. I don't know if you remember that. It lasted right up until the second service needed to start. And then second service, Jonathan and I stood here and the band played for an hour and a half. Just praying for people. I wonder if there's somebody bold enough this morning. Something that we prayed for last week. Something you're asking God for that he made good on this week. Come on. There's got to be somebody. Somebody here this morning. You got a testimony to share. Want to take a moment if there's anybody. Is there anybody? Come on, Marie. Come on. You gotta have the guts. Amen.
So what I have to say is that when I came up towards Pete praying for me last Sunday, then I had my family heavy on my heart. Because, like, not that they don't know God, but they don't live for God in their lives. And so I came up, and he prayed for me, and I've really, really been praying for my husband for quite some time. And I'm just saying, God, reach out to him in a way that I can't, because I don't, you know. But when he prayed for me, it kind of took that stress off of me, and I said, Lord, I give it to you. And when that happened, I have seen a change, and I am praying for more, and I am hoping and praying that he's going to come to church and worship God and live his life for God, and I am still praying that he will just be filled with the Holy Spirit and that he will be changed by the glory of our Lord and God, Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. So, Lord, we stand with Marie, and we ask in Jesus' name that it be done. Amen. What's your name?
My name is Alexi.
Alexi, what do you got?
So last week I didn't come to this church, but I got to bear my testimony there. And I've been praying for all these people I'm in rehab with. I struggle with drug addiction. And so God is working through me to give the authority to these people and teach them how to live sober and clean and not use drugs anymore. Like I have these people who guide me and tell me how to do it. I'm not being so angry anymore. They're guiding me to be kind. They're guiding me to share love and share light into these people's lives.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Do you stand with her? Come on. Amen. Somebody else. Somebody else. Just a quick testimony. Anybody else? Come on. God doing something in your life? Amen. Well, God, we just take everything that we've prayed about, everything that's on people's hearts, all of this stuff, God, that you're doing and that you're about. I pray that you make it real. I pray that you make it relevant. God, and I pray that you have the final say in all of our lives in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. 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 You can be seated this morning. Give glory to God one more time, would you? Come on. In just a minute, we're going to move into a time of greeting one another, a time of responding to the Lord with our faithfulness, with our money, with our turning our tithes to the Lord, bringing our offerings into his house, just doing the things that the Bible says to do that cause us to be obedient. You know what I'm talking about? Amen. How many of you know that boy, he's faithful, isn't he? So shouldn't we be faithful too? Amen. Amen. Just want to tell you about three things Jonathan already mentioned. Square One is happening next week, 1 week from today. Some of you have already been, many of you haven't. But even if you've been before and you want to come again, it's at my house. It is wonderful to have folks in our house to talk about Jesus and talk about what's happening at TLC, how TLC got started, what we believe and who we are. A month after that, mark your calendars. The dates are running through on the screens during the greeting and at the beginning of service. But square two is going to happen in February. Square two is the time that we're going to talk about what it means to be a four-squared church. A lot of people think that TLC is a non-denominational church because we have this kind of worship style. We're not a non-denominational church. We are proudly denominational. Amen. We believe that having an authority structure and leadership is a very healthy, important part of the body of Christ. That being said, it comes with some issues. Amen. How many of you know your kids need authority, right? But doesn't that come with issues, right? So you need to know as a four-square church how we deal with issues, how we support missions, how we deal with missionaries, how we deal with pastoral transitions and financial transactions and all of that stuff. If you're interested in learning that, also going to talk about Amy Semple McPherson and the healing ministry that she had, the movement that has grown from one woman to over 12 million people on 120 countries, in 120 countries, with over 100,000 congregations around the world. We're going to talk about that story. And then the following month, coming in March, mark your calendars, we'll have square three. I told you we're a four-square church. Square one is a week from tonight. Square two's in February. Square three is in March. And that's the time that we talk about your role at TLC. How can your ministry giftedness be identified and be released and be supported in this local church body? That's square three. Square one, we'll have some dessert and coffee. Square two, we as a church will provide a barbecue dinner for you. That just got filled up right there. That, sign me up. Square three, you're going to provide a potluck dinner for me. Amen. Square one, just informative. Here's who we are. Square two is a little bit deeper. We're going to deal with that over a meal. Square three is about how you plug into the body, so we're going to ask you to bring the food. How many of you know the church is a battleship, not a love boat? Amen. Every person needs a place to serve. And I'm telling you what, God is ramping things up in this body. And he's laying it on my heart, and I know I'm not the only one. He's saying it's time to get the people focused and directed, because I'm fixing to do something way cool. Amen. Amen. Hey, would you stand back to your feet? Come on, all around the room. Oh, would you just stick your hands up in the air? Come on. I know it might be weird, but spirit of unity, would you? Come on. Come on. Just get your hands and just reach to the sky. Oh, with an innocent heart, would you say this with me? Say, Lord, I'm here to know you better, to learn more about you, to learn my place in your kingdom, to know to a greater degree how to serve you in faithfulness. Make me an instrument of your grace. Show me your love. Help me pass that on to those around me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Give the Lord praise. We're going to be back in a few minutes.
Good morning, True Life. Good morning.
Yeah, dude, Jill's making me a cup. Can you go get it? Fantastic. Good to see you all this morning. Wasn't worship awesome? Oh, it's always awesome. Can I just remind you? Sometimes I think we live in this environment. We come to this church, we get to do church together as a family and all this kind of stuff, and we kind of forget what we have. Yeah. Right? We kind of get used to stuff like this. Let's not forget that God is doing some unbelievable stuff. And as Pete just said, get ready because he's on the move still. And again, and is getting very pointed. So, man, let's just hop on the bus. See what he's got for us, because y'all are amazing. Just the way it goes. Just a question, a curiosity. How many of y'all like make New Year's resolutions? Nobody. One, it's me and really, y'all are lying to me. Really, you guys don't even care to get better.
I resolved years ago to not make New Year's resolutions. I've kept that one for 20 years.
He's kept his one New Year's resolution for 20 years. Yeah, I'm not going to make a New Year's resolution. I'm not sure, man. I'm a little bit discouraged with y'all, man. Just like, most of us want to change, get better, accomplish something more, you know? Not this place. I don't know. I didn't think I knew too many people who wanted to be the same at the end of this year that they started out this year with, but you all just changed my mind. I'm like, we're good with who I am. Just going to lay it right here. I'm just joking. I just don't need to make one. I'm just always changing. So I think the idea, though, really is that we always want to change, right? We always want to grow, achieve, produce. Even my dad and mom, 80, 78, 6, whatever she is, 29. I can't keep up with it, man. They're just out there doing what they do and achieving goals and all this kind of stuff. And so all you young people who think life ends at 50, I'm just telling you, they still think they're 29. They think they're 29. They act like they're 29. Over the course of the last several weeks, and especially since our friend Ed Ritchie's death, since he passed away, I just need to let you guys know that his death really affected me. It just made me think in a good way, in a really, really good way. It affected me in the idea that I started thinking about, because it's so close to the New Year's, and the New Year's, I've been thinking about the choices that we make, and about the choices we get to make that's similar to what Ed made before he passed away to get him to where he was, who he was as a person, who Ed and Linda, the things that they did as for life, right? And so it really started making me think, how do we celebrate somebody like that? What choices did they make, right? I don't know if you guys ever made New Year's resolutions or whatever. I have to resolve every day, you know? I'm just going to be resolved to be a good husband, a good father. I'm going to resolve to stay at my job now. Have you ever been faced with a decision that you felt like you were woefully inadequate to make at that moment? But you had to make a choice. You had to make this decision, right? Well, I've been there with my career. Like I told you, probably this last year, sometime when I was sent to the curriculum committee with no information, woefully inadequate to be in that room at that time. However, now I've learned from that and I can handle it, right? But I had to make a decision to do, and everything I decided was wrong. It's just not. Hold up a minute, my computer keeps... You know you're a boring preacher when your computer goes to sleep on you. True story. There's too many buttons to push.
right, I think I might be there.
Okay, let's see if that'll stay on. Right, is it in that moment in my career that I realize that I'm in a moment that I do not have the skill set to do what I'm being asked to do? Right, we've been there, we've done that. There are other moments in my life where I had to make choices. We're not necessarily about skill set, but in 2010, you guys know, I've been vulnerable with you guys about the growth in my life and what God is doing in my life. But in 2010, we lost almost everything. Felt like God had abandoned me. I wanted to run away from Cedar City. I wanted to get out of here because there was just too much pain. I knew I shouldn't. Way down deep inside, I knew that would not be the right decision, but I wanted to. I was looking for jobs. I was doing whatever I could. Down deep inside, I knew that if I did not take care of whatever mistakes I made here, they would just follow me. I would just repeat that stuff, right? But I called a friend in Salt Lake, and I was talking to him about everything, and he said, no, you shouldn't run. If you try to leave, you're just running away. It's not what I wanted to hear. Call another friend for counsel. Maybe he'll tell me something different. Tells me the same thing. Can I just tell you that if you call more than one person to get counsel, all you're looking for is agreement. You're not looking for counsel. Yeah. They didn't agree with me. So here I am. The Bible says in a multitude of counselors, there's safety. Right, so you got to listen to people who are counseling you, right? If they keep saying the same thing, you probably ought to listen, right? And all kind of stuff. So, right, we need people to guide us. Or actually, it's a good thing if they do. Wouldn't it be great if you walked into our church the first time, you had somebody to guide you through what just happened? We're all used to church. We know what's going to happen. We're comfortable with it. We love what we're doing and all that good stuff, but when you come in here and you don't know what to expect, and you come from a church that's really reserved, it'd be nice to have a guide sitting beside you like, okay, here's what's going to happen next. This is what's going to look like, right? So as each time you have this expectation, they're going to turn the lights down in the sanctuary, and the stage lights are going to come on, and fog's going to happen. I just want you to know why we do that. Like, guide us through that stuff, right? The music's going to be loud. If you need some earplugs, here you go. Right, just to kind of like walk you through each expectation and all this kind of stuff, and they're going to pray for people, and they're going to, whatever it is, and you're going to feel overwhelmed. The feeling, this is why you have that feeling, right? It'd just be good to have that guide. Even in church, they'd be like, oh, now I'm comfortable. Every year we go to Fiji and Tonga, and we go there so often that we're used to it. Just like I said, don't get used to this, we get used to this. So we go to Fiji. Anybody been to Fiji? I'm striking out with you guys today. Nobody's going into change, and nobody wants to go to Fiji. Anybody want to go to Fiji? Yes. There we go. Jump in my bag, let's go. You can't get there right now. They are not letting anybody in. I guess if you're American, they're not letting you in. Too much COVID. So we go there so often that I get used to things, right? I still think it's beautiful. I still think it's awesome. That's why I keep going back. The people are unbelievable. But I have these kids that come with me a new group of kids coming. And one year, this last year, we're in the airport. We're driving to the resort, and it dawns on me. I look back in the van, and they're staring out the window in awe. I'm like, oh, yeah. They need a guide. So I started using this term, we're getting ready to do this, and it's going to blow your mind. We're going to go zip line through the jungle, and it's going to blow your mind. We're going to go visit this village, and we're going to interact, and the people are going to blow your mind. Just so they can see what I see and feel what I feel when I'm there. Is that right? So I become this guide to them, and not just a teacher, but wouldn't it be great if we have people all come alongside of us to help us guide us with life choices? Right? Well, we call them coaches. We call them teachers. We want to start something new, and it doesn't matter what it is. It could be a hobby. you know, new eating habits, career, exercise skills, whatever it is. But we need to find somebody who is better than us at that so they can help us actually get better, help us through that. And we call that person a coach because they know more. They've done it. They know all of the things that you need to know. So if you want to do something new, the best thing to do is find somebody who's the right person to help you teach you that, right? Somebody who knows what they're doing. So if I want to learn to exercise, I'm going to look around. I'm going to find the fit person, the person who is in shape, who has exercised, who knows, right? And they've been that way for years. I'm not going to find the person who started their newest exercise routine on January 1st, and it's January 10th today, and they may have already given up. That's not the person that I want influencing my exercise routine, right? If I want to learn new eating habits, healthy eating, I'm asking the lady who loves kale. Right? That's what I'm going to do. Right? If I want to learn to live well, I'm going to ask the person who has lived well. This takes me back to Ed. Right? So I'm overwhelmed with these thoughts and looking at the life of Ed, 80 years old, a life well lived. He finished strong. He lived strong. He finished well. And you know, in our everyday instant access to everyone, media and people are super eager to expose anyone's failure. Men and women of God who we thought were strong or who were strong, right, ended up failing at some point in their lives, and that gets exposed, or they actually gave up on the gospel, and you know, something had destroyed them. So there's a worship leader. I don't know if you know his name. His name is Marty Sampson. He's a worship leader for Hillsong. So a lot of the songs we sang this morning came out of Hillsong. Hillsong in Sydney, Australia, has been a leader in where worship is going for the last 20, 30 years. I don't know, a long, long time. Anyways, Marty Sampson this year left the faith. He's one of the great songwriters, worship leaders, tweeted out this year that he's no longer a Christian. My heart breaks for the damage and the pain that he went through to come to this conclusion. My heart breaks for the people who followed him and is now damaged because of his decision. And you're going to see in a minute that your choices have far-reaching implications. And then there's Ed. There's the Ed all we know. Is it okay that I talk it? I should have asked your permission first. If I want to simply learn how to live a life that is full and productive life, I'll ask Ed. Or I should have asked Ed. But how many times do we wait too long to ask before it's too late? Here's a man who simply built what he loved. His death had me evaluating my own life choices in light of his life. I'm sitting at a funeral of him, and everybody getting up there is talking about Ed and the relationships they had with him and what they did and how he laughed and he did this and he did that. Nobody talked about what he did, where he worked, his career. So when you build your life, you're going to eventually look back to something that you built. What does it look like? You don't even have to be old to look back. I'm not old and I look back. Seriously, I'm not old, you guys. My dad's old.
He's 29.
I'm still in my 50s. Yeah, he's 29. He's younger than me. Right? But you don't even have to be old. You can just look back over what last year, what did you build? And that's where I come to New Year's resolutions. When we come into new things, we have this tendency to look back and see how we've changed, right? COVID changed you. COVID was very destructive on the family, this at least of America. destroyed people, destroyed family relationships, made people abusive because all of a sudden they had to spend hours together. We didn't know how to handle that. On the other side, COVID built families. It made them closer. It made them more sympathetic to each other. It just happens to be the choices that we make facing those situations. At the end of your life, you're going to look back and see what you built. You may think or say you love something, but you build something else. Right? Where do you spend your money? Where do you spend your time? Where do you spend your thoughts? Where do you spend your energy? You build a life with the choices that you make. At the end of your life, you're going to see what you built, and we're going to see what you loved. See, I've heard a lot of people, mostly men, fathers, husbands, who work for money, and tell their family, well, I'm working for you. Without ever spending time with their family. Really, you love money. You know, can I just slam that down real quick? Really, you love money, not your family. So I'm sitting here at Ed's funeral, and I get to see what he built and what he loved. Because people are getting up there, and they're talking about him. Now, we've all been to funerals where we know that person was okay. But there are also some things, and I've been at a funeral, and I'm like, really, humans are nice. When we talk about somebody at their funeral, we say nice things about them, whether we ever thought they were nice or not. And sometimes I'm like, wow, I didn't know that side of that person. I only knew the scoundrel part of it. No, you couldn't find that in Ed. You cannot put your finger anywhere on Ed's life. He built what he loved. Nobody talked about his career. They mentioned his skill at woodworking or whatever, but in context of relationship and what it was, a context of building life of people. And he built what he loved, and that was family and people. The material that he used to build was people. You can tell what he loved by what he did at the end of his life. What he showed at the end of his life. So this made me, so I'm going to ramble. So I say all of that to say this, to get me to this point of, I'm going to ramble with you a little bit so you can see my thought process of choices connected to Ed's life. This just was this convergence of random thoughts put together as I began to understand the choices that we make based on a man who lived well, made the right choices. That you build what you love. Number one. Yes, there we go. You build what you love. Matthew 16:18. Jesus have a conversation with his disciples. And he says this. On this rock, he says, you're Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And all of a sudden I'm like, what did Jesus love? Because if you build what you love, we realize that the material that Jesus built with was actually people. It's all about people. You see, Jesus never wrote a book. He didn't build temples. He didn't build buildings. Nothing tangible can be found in history, preserved through history, that says Jesus built this. Solomon built a temple and it was glorious. David tried to build a temple, but he built a kingdom. Right? Humans have this idea of building glorious things. Right? We want to achieve success to what we want to be known for something. We want to be good at something, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's put into us by our Creator. So we pour ourselves into it. We spend time perfecting it, learning it, practicing it, tasting it, brewing it. Smelling the aroma, starting over, changing the coffee to water ratio, roasting a little bit longer, a little bit shorter, changing the water temperatures, finding a new bean from a new country, until we get that unbelievable cup of coffee. And then we start over again. You know what it's like, right? Maybe not with coffee, but in your own life. And when we meet somebody new, we ask them, what do you do? Oh, I'm a professor. We often find our identity in what we do and the tangible things that we build. I built my life around being a pastor and being a professor. And when those things get misplaced and become my love, I began to have a problem. Jesus didn't build his life around stuff. The only thing that Jesus left was a legacy, was the church. Was the church. This is his legacy. You and I, right? We tend to think the church is a system or an institution, but it's not. It's not buildings and cathedrals and all this cool stuff. Humans, we get our hands on the church and we start building legacies to ourselves. Bigger buildings, cathedrals, fancy things. We write books. We get our name in the lights. But we know the church isn't a building. It's not a system. It's not an institution. It's humanity. It's you and I, and Jesus loves humans. Jesus loves people. Sometimes we say we love something and we build something else. So pastors sometimes get together, get the wrong idea, and they're building a legacy to themselves out of you and I instead of letting Jesus build people. He wanted to restore us. But see, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. He's not just building, he's building something strong, powerful. And he goes on to say, I will give you the keys to the kingdom. In other words, not only that, I am giving you authority. Pastor Peter already talked about the disciples so excited about casting out demons and healing the sick. Jesus already told them, I've given you authority. I've given you the keys to the kingdom. So if we build what we love, then we'll also sacrifice for what we love. If you want to see what you love, look to see what you sacrifice for. If you want to see what you love, look to see what you sacrifice for. Ephesians chapter 5, 25 through 27. For husbands, this means love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. He gave his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He made a sacrifice for the church. You give up something to get what you want. Years ago, I just did something to my computer and my notes are gone. Help. Oh, ha, ha. You guys, I should just use paper. Please. They're back. Almost had to ad lib, and that would not be good. Maybe it would be good. So years ago, you all know that we used to own the coffee shop, The Grind. That was our business. It's what made us money. It was connected to our church. It's what gave us inroads to the community, and God did some amazing, amazing things with that. But I was working long hours building a business. And one day on the way home, it was like around midnight, because we would open the coffee shop and we would do all kinds of concerts and comedy improv and everything. Oh, my mic is down here. Should I put my mic on? Steve is like waving at me like, you should have done that about 20 minutes ago. You guys can hear me now. I just need to go fully analog and just put a mic right here where I don't have to touch it. It's too many things to think about. So we sold the grind. So we made the decision. I was going home and I was just like so tired. And I think I had missed something that my boys were participating in because the business called me away. I missed a lot of their lives because I was in love with a coffee shop. And I could say that I loved my family, but I was sacrificing for something else. Are you with me? So I gave up the business, gave up my income, so I could spend the last 2 years of my kids, Elise, Jordan, and Cameron's lives while they were in high school, because I didn't know that they're going to move away, they're going to do whatever. And I didn't want to miss their lives. Because if they are the most important, what have I done? I've even confused Facebook. We're good? Are we good? Thank God for technology and the people who run it. Right? So I said I love my family, but I'm sacrificing for my business. So I give up the business so I could spend more. That was a hard choice, and we faced lean financial times after that. But I'll tell you what, I am so glad that I sacrificed for my family, that I intentionally made that choice in that moment. Because God still provided. God still was there. It was a hard choice because that was our livelihood, but there it was. I have no regrets of choosing my family first. I do not look back on them because I still have all of my sons who still love me. I have a wife who still cares for me. I had a choice. Sacrifice for the business or sacrifice for my family? Stephanie and I made a decision on Friday. We chatted about it a little bit and had an opportunity to teach in Rome this summer. So we talk about it. And so I would get paid for teaching in Rome, but everything I got paid, I would use to live in Rome. Right, the plane ticket over there and all this kind of stuff. And you all know that I would kind of like to travel. So if they're going to pay me to travel, I'll do that. The deal is we would get paid, and I would teach in Rome, and I would have the weekends, and so we would travel. So it actually cost us money to go to Rome. Or we could stay here, teach at SUU for the summer, make some money, put it in the bank. We'd have some extra money. What do y'all think we chose? What do you sacrifice for? You sacrifice for what you love. So now you all need to pray that I get accepted to teach in Rome. We still got that process to go through, right? So here we are. Sometimes we make decisions that seem that they don't have any consequences, but they do have far-reaching implications. Are you with me? How are the decisions that I make today going to impact the people around me? How are they going to impact me in the future? Where is this going to lead me? I chose to work long hours at the coffee shop. Those long hours had far-reaching implications. I chose to not, and I still have those, right? That I now have my family around me, because sometimes we don't know. Had I chosen money over family? Had I built on money instead of family? Implications could have been that I lose my family. My wife will only believe me for so long that I'm making money for you. Jesus sacrificed for the church. A bunch of people who couldn't seem to get it all together. But when we do, we're glorious. When we do, there's nothing that can stop us. And when we don't, His grace is sufficient. It's okay because I'm invested
in you. And then we found that Jesus actually chose with intention. Oh, I'm really more than struggling here. Here we go. Choose with intention. There's a verse in the Bible that shows this more clear than anything that I can ever tell you. Jesus is on his way to the cross. And he's praying. He says, Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering from me. Yet not what I want to be done. Yet I want to do your, I can get this. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. He chose you with intention. He knew the choice was hard. He knew his death was coming, but he still chose you. He still chose the church. You see, you build what you love. You sacrifice for what you love because you choose with intention. If you realize that you build what you love, the material with what you build are the relationships you have in your life. I realize that Ed and Linda have built what they loved with the family and the friends around them. And at the end of this all, they look back and you can be sure that we get to see what they loved. You see, I think one of the greatest tragedy of American culture today, our society, they have been telling people, your choices have no consequences. You can choose destructive things to do without needing to go through the destruction that you're causing, without having any negative consequences. I really, really believe that it's one of the leading reasons we have mental breakdown in America today. Because we have the consequences. And we've told that my choices have no bearing. I can make destructive choices without the consequences. And I have the consequences, and I don't know why I have consequences, but because I've been told a lie. So I mentally do not know what to do with this. We're facing an epidemic of psychological upheaval in America. And I believe one of it is because we've been telling people a lie that your choices have no consequences. Your choices affect others and they affect yourselves. I have a responsibility to those I'm in relationship with to choose intentionally. I have that relationship. I have no idea what my choices, how they're going to affect people. It's my choices are either going to make people whole or it's going to destroy them. Or it has the potential to. Right? Some of you lived with alcoholic families, fathers, mothers, and you realize the choices of that affected you today. Some of us will use that. Now understand that as a Christian, you have a new father. You got a new dad. You get a new identity. And we need to overcome the past of somebody else. Regardless, they affected you. So I can make a choice for my son's future. I get to make a choice for my grandkids. Children, talking to you. I wonder if they're even going to look at this. I'm going to go tell them to watch. I'm making choices today that have far-reaching implications on people I don't even know yet. Stay with me in this because I choose intentionally. You see, my wife and I chose intentionally to make the Word of God center of our family, not an addition to. We lived by the Word of God. When we went through struggles, we brought the Word of God. It was an intentional choice. People, you need to know that if you do not make the Word of God central to your family, there are far-reaching implications. I have a responsibility to those I'm in relationship to make the right decision because it's going to affect people. It's either going to make them whole or it's going to destroy them. So when you choose, remember you are investing in people and that people are the material by which you build. Because there's nothing more important to God than people. Nothing. He doesn't care about your house. He doesn't care about your home, your car. He doesn't care about your money. He cares about you. He cares about people. We are important to God. And if we're important to God, then I must choose with intention to invest in people. To make the right decisions for people. You see, I'm not the most outgoing guy. Pete is. He loves hanging out with people, doing stuff. He goes crazy. It's what fuels him. If he was made to stay home for 3 days all by himself, it'd be quarantined to the worst. I, on the other hand, love y'all, but sometimes I need to get away from you. I need to go home, sit in my basement, and be a hermit and recharge. However, there are times when I love being a hermit way too much. I have to take myself out and realize that people are important. I was looking at my notes on my phone, 2016. I came across a New Year's resolution. Since there's only two of us to do this in this room, it said, spend more time with people. I had a list of people that I needed to intentionally spend more time with, to invest in. Because they were important to me. My wife was on that list. My parents were on that list. Don't judge me for putting my wife and my parents on a list of people. But Troy's all like, you got to make a list and spend time with your parents? What? Don't judge me, Troy. I've been married for 30 years now. I'm a slow learner. Some of you husbands need to put your wife on a list. You need to put your parents on a list. Sometimes I have to remind myself of the things that are really important to me. And I have to re-up. I have to recommit. That my job is not that important. My relationships are important. I have to choose with intention. You see, I have to own my influence. Like it or not, the choices I make affect those people I love. We all have influence over people. So my question is, what happens when people get close to you? We've often heard this, and I don't even like this saying. Broken people break people. But Jesus shows us this moment that to choose love is a choice to be whole. I'm going to take us back to Ephesians chapter 25 through 27. For husbands, this means to love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present her, the church, to himself, a what? Glorious church. Okay, he did it to do what? A glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. When we choose Jesus, we are made whole. When we are choose Jesus, he frees us from sin. When we make the choice to choose Jesus, we're made holy. We're made glorious. Somebody in here say, I'm glorious.
I'm glorious.
Come on, church, we're glorious. We're clean. We We've been restored because we chose Jesus. Because that's what coming into relationship with Jesus does. It makes people whole. Can we have the band come up here? Because I'm getting ready to ask you some questions. And I want you to respond to the word of the Lord. If somebody chooses Jesus, they're made whole. This is what the Bible just said. Are you with me? What if somebody chooses me to love? Will it make them whole? Sit there for a minute. If someone chooses to love me, will it make them whole? If someone who is broken, rough edges, hard to love, chooses to love me, will it make their life better? What happens to human beings when they get close to you? What happens to human beings when they're affected by the gravitational pull of your choices? What happened to human beings when Ed loved them? They were made whole. When Linda loved them, they're made whole. See, that's the beautiful thing about Ed's life. To love him was to be made whole. And we saw that at his funeral. If you get close to Ed and Linda, you got to be built up and made whole. Now we get to do this, right? This is a part of who you are as a child of God. This is what Jesus said. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink, for the scriptures declare rivers of living water flow from his heart. The King James Version says will flow from his belly. All it's saying is from the core of who you are will flow life. We know that from the core of who Christ is flows life. But Jesus is saying, if you believe in me, will flow life. Out of your life, you can pour into somebody else's life hope. You can pour into somebody else's life compassion. Out of your life, you can pour into somebody else's life forgiveness. And when somebody opens up their soul to you, you can pour in the living waters of Jesus Christ, of the Holy Spirit that makes somebody whole. If somebody who is broken chooses to love you, will you make them whole? Will it make them whole? Because love changes the way you live. Who do you love enough to change for? Who do you love enough to change for? Who do you love enough to choose intentionally? Sometimes we have to make hard choices. And human beings, we're pretty selfish. We like to take care of ourselves. But Jesus said, love your neighbor as... Yeah. If my neighbor chooses to love me, will they be made whole? Will they be made whole? I love my wife. I love my children. I love my church. But my values and my priorities then need to change, to show that they are the important thing in my life, that they are what I want to build my life on. Care about the people who are entrusted to me. My choice to love God with all of my heart, my soul, my mind, and my strength has direct implications on those around me. I want to make those choices. Can you just bow your heads with me this morning? Some of you, I don't know where we are this morning with your, where you are this morning with your life choice. I don't know if you've chosen Jesus. I don't know if you've chosen him to be Lord and Savior of your life. But if that's you this morning, I choose intentionally to choose him. It's simple. Jesus, I choose you. I believe you. For the rest of us, we all know what it's like to be Christians and love and live and learn and all kind of stuff. I'm going to ask you. For me, I needed to re-up. My New Year's resolution is re-up. Choose intentionally. I choose intentionally all the time. You see, there's miracles in this house today. I'm going to let you go. I know I'm over time, but I'm going to let you go in a minute. But here's what I want you to do. We're going to sing. And as the band is playing, if you're ready to say, you know what? I think I've made some choices in my life that were not aligned with what I said I love, and I'm ready to choose. I'm ready to sacrifice. I'm ready to do the right thing. I want you just to begin to stand and worship with the band. Just want you to say, you know what, this is me. Got my life together, I get it. But I've misplaced and I just need to re-up.
Blood. Do you believe that this morning? I know you do, and here's what I'm talking today. I'm talking about your future. I was talking about you starting now and moving to your future. Some of you are like, I just don't tell you. I've made some poor decisions in my past. I was not equipped and capable to make the right choices. But God is faithful. His grace is sufficient. He'll restore what you messed up. You can believe for the future. Right implications, it doesn't matter. God will restore your past. And he will make straight your ways in the future. Come on, somebody give the Lord some praise this morning. Would you go celebrate who Jesus is this week and have a good day. See you later.